In Melbourne, Australia, there was a big chunk of China. This vibrant Chinatown speaks to a long and proud history. Drawn by the gold rush, Chinese settlers first came here in the 1850s. And it's a similar story today, with more than a third of all Chinese migrants to Australia choosing to live in Melbourne. But of course, the traffic goes the other way too. You're about to hear two extraordinary stories from two extraordinary people. One, a man steeped in all things China.
China market is like a market nowhere else in the world. It does blow your mind to think that a country that has come so far so quickly and continues to expand with enormous ambition and capital behind it.
The other is Ben Dingle, a fifth-generation farmer who made billions out of A2 cow's milk before he decided to stop kidding around and export goat's milk to China instead.
We're in a great category. So goat milk is growing about five times faster than cow milk.
In Melbourne recently, they met up with my colleague Mark Llewellyn to speak about the big picture. First up was David Olson, the National President of the Australia-China Business Council. So, take it away, Mark.
David, welcome to the big picture.
Thank you very much.
So what is the big picture between Australia and China now? Good, bad, or somewhere in between?
Well, I think nobody could call it in a good state. It's a very difficult relationship at the moment. But, you know, we are where we are. We're living with it, and we're working through that process right now.
When you say we are where we are, where's that?
Well, we're in the middle of extraordinary change in the world. You know, we're coming out of a COVID environment, which has completely disrupted our ability to connect with each other, to travel to each other's places. So that's caused a huge disruption of personal and business relationships. We've got China emerging as a nation, you know, of great influence and power in the world. It is a great power. And then you've got the whole technological overlay on everything as well. You know, technology is moving at such an extraordinary pace. China's right at the forefront of many of the new technologies. And that is causing all sorts of frictions. You know, whichever way you look at it, you know, we're embroiled in the most extraordinary, you know, complication of issues, you know, that we've seen in generations, perhaps forever.
When you put it that way, for some people, that just might be so intimidating. Like they just throw up their hands, what do I do? What do I do? What's your advice?
For business people, you try to do your best. You know, business has continued to engage with China, and despite all the things you read in the press, the negativity about, you know, the business relationship with China, it's at all-time highs. So
really?
We are connecting. Yes, indeed.
How do you explain that?
It's largely driven by the price of iron ore,
yep,
and commodities. I think you can't delude ourselves into thinking that our relationship is super strong. But even if you take out the rising price of iron ore and the huge volumes that have gone over the last year or so, there's still an enormous strength in that business and economic relationship. There are still Australian exporters, manufacturers exporting to China. And I think the interesting thing about this is that Australian service providers are now really finding new opportunities to engage with China in a way which we've never seen before.
In what way?
Well, China's changing dramatically. It's moving to becoming a far more consumer-oriented economy. It's rising middle class. Now 400-odd million people, you know, over the last 20 years have become middle-class consumers.
Yeah.
They all desire better products, clean food, good products, and good services. We've got demand for what we do well.
When he is not in Melbourne, David resides in Hong Kong as International Director of King & Wood Mallinson's, one of the world's largest law firms. For the past 25 years, he's been helping Australian companies navigate the complexities of cross-border trade and investment with China.
It's a world where on one side you see the negative side in the press, and you know that's the prevailing, you know, view, I think, in the community, but there's a lot of strong business activity that continues.
Yeah, this is an extraordinary point you're making here. It appears on one side the scale is weighted and it's a bad, bad situation. On the other, the scale is equally weighted, but there's opportunity. But if you're a business entrepreneur, if you're looking to invest in China, if you're looking to have a crack, would your advice be to sit back and wait, or would it be to plan something in the knowledge that there's opportunity?
Well, I think the first point to understand is you've got to look at China. It is such a big, dynamic market. Mm-hmm. You need to understand who your consumer is, what they want, how they want it delivered, when they want it delivered, and where. You know, to be truthful, there are many products that we sell from Australia that are premium products, but they could be quite easily purchased out of Europe or the United States or other markets.
You need to be unique.
So you need to be unique, and you need to understand how your product or service is aligned to China's ambitions and growth strategies for the future. Where do you look? Well, starting point is obviously, you know, China's development strategy. Its 14th five-year plan, which is out there in the market right now. That gives you basically a pretty good guideline as to what China's priorities are in terms of the growth of its economy, the development of its society and its needs for the next 5 years and even beyond.
What are the priorities? I mean, you've studied it.
Well,
you've written about it.
I have written a bit about it. You know, look, it's a big document. It's a massive document which sets the really big strategic directions for China. They want to clean up the economy. They want to raise the living standards for their communities. They want to be a technological leader. They want to innovate and they want to be competitive in their own right. So they're going to grow and they're going to continue to invest in being the best that they can be.
But I can't see that here from this beautiful top floor of this Melbourne office block. I can't see that to understand that you're going to be on the ground. Is that what you're saying?
I think it's important to go there to get a sense of the urgency with which we must act to respond to what's going on at the moment. China is not standing still.
You know, that personal connection, which has been disrupted by COVID, has gone. Do we need to re-engage in that sense?
It's probably the most important thing we should be focused on right now. You know, sitting here in Australia, it's clear that we're not going to get a resolution of our difficulties, certainly at a political level, in the near term. It's going to take some time to do that. What we do have, to our advantage, is a strong personal and people connections with China.
And they're important?
Oh, hugely important. You know, we've got a million, you know, people, Chinese diaspora here in Australia, all of whom have connections back to China in some way or other. We have businesses that are engaging significantly, you know, with the China market. These are important. We need to maintain those connections because at the end of the day, you know, a nation is not a nation that makes decisions. A nation makes decisions through individuals. Yeah, and businesses make decisions through individuals. They're collections of individuals that come together to make decisions. And that can only be grounded on personal understandings and ultimately trust.
To fully understand how powerful these personal connections can be to a business, we turn now to Ben Dingle. This entrepreneurial farmer made his first fortune out of A2 cow's milk before seeing the potential and the potential profits of goat's milk infant formula sold to China.
Ben, welcome to the program.
Hi.
Now, why goat's milk? Why China?
First, China is the biggest infant formula market in the world. Roughly about 2/3 of the global market is China. Why goat's milk? Goat's milk is considered the closest alternative to human breast milk. It has natural oligosaccharides, which are prebiotics. It enhances the good bugs in the gut and it reduces the bad bugs in the gut. And why is that good? Is that it helps digestion and it makes us healthier. And if we're healthier, that enhances our immunity. So that's why Oli6 goat milk is so good.
Goat's milk, it's not something people would have thought of initially. It's a niche product back then. How did you change it from niche to not niche?
Well, interestingly, in China, especially in central China, a lot of people told me stories about how they were fed goat's milk as a kid. So people in central China have had widely held intergenerational belief about the fact that goat's milk is good.
So how did you know? How did you learn? How did you get there?
Well, I've been in the sector forever. I'm part of a family that's fifth generation farmers. I grew up on a farm. I spent 10 years working on a farm. Then I became involved in a company manufacturing milk And now I'm able to bring the benefits of goat milk nutrition to mums and their babies. So farming, I understood that happy, healthy animals make high quality milk.
Do you have happy goats?
Yes. If they're not happy, they're not producing great milk. It's all about the focus on top-notch quality. And those are the things you need to bring the benefits to mum and her baby. The first time I went to China, I was in Shanghai and climbed up the Pearl Tower. I looked around and I thought, wow, here's 24 million people.
Yeah.
This is the population of Australia, and probably the error in the count is the population of New Zealand. And they're all here in this city, 24 million people. Look at the scale of this market. And then I went down the tower. So I wandered into a shopping centre, which is the biggest shopping centre I'd ever been in. And all the luxury brands were front and centre in that shopping centre. And I looked at the prices and I thought, wow, there's no discount here. These consumers are paying plenty for well-recognised brands. And this shopping centre is massive. And that's when I started to realise the power of China and the power of the Chinese consumer and the potential.
You weren't intimidated, you were inspired.
I was inspired. I soaked it up. I recognised here's a huge, huge opportunity.
In a country of over 1 billion, it was one person who made the critical difference.
I hear, though, that it was one woman in particular who took a fancy to the product, and from there things grew. What happened?
So we first launched Ollie 6 infant formula in 2016 here in Australia. At that stage, somebody sent a can up to a mum in China. She was having all sorts of problems. It just was very difficult for this mum and her family. She tried Ollie 6 and all those problems went away. And do you know, mums are so busy with newborns, but she still took the time to send us a note. And that's what she said. I was using this cow brand. I tried Ollie 6. All the problems went away. Can you send me another case? What she also said is, I don't care what it costs. I don't care what it costs.
And how did that lead to more mums in China? Was it word of mouth through her?
So word of mouth is really important. Peer endorsement is really important. As a brand, you need to go out with a clear message and you need to connect with consumers. But they will look to other mums to endorse what you're saying and give it credibility. And our stated vision from day one has been providing food for a better life. Now, that mum was having a hell of a time. She was having a hell of a time. It was difficult. Anybody with children knows how challenging that can be, not only for the baby, but for everybody in the family.
Oh, the sleep-deprived parents.
The sleep-deprived
parents. The kids that can't get to sleep because the bub is awake.
It's very difficult.
Do you come face-to-face with the mums? Do you see how fierce they can get when they examine your product? Do they look at you?
Absolutely, I come face-to-face with them. And they are, I would say, very honest, which is fantastic. It just keeps us on our toes. And ultimately, we need to understand our consumers. How do they see value? How do they see value? It's difficult for me. I'm a 58-year-old, white, Caucasian guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's difficult for me to understand what a 28-year-old Chinese mum who lives in a third-tier city in Sichuan province, let's say, how she thinks.
Seems like you're a quick learner.
We love doing this. We absolutely love delivering food for a better life.
There's a paradox operating in the world today. COVID seems to have put so much of our lives on hold, but life hasn't stood still, especially in China.
China moves incredibly quickly, incredibly quickly. We tick along pretty well here, but I would say that in general we tend to be laggards.
Yes.
China moves fast.
Yep.
And it's such a big place, there's so many people, it's so competitive. You need to be there, you need your finger on the pulse, and you need to be, you know, able to respond to opportunities as they come along quickly.
For some people, that'd be hugely intimidating.
Look, I guess for some people it is. But I've always found China is very welcoming, you know, accommodating of different cultures, different people, welcoming diversity, because there's an enormous amount of diversity in China.
Yeah.
Well, we think, we sort of talk China and like it's, you know, a very one-dimensional concept. It is far, far, far from that. As long as you're prepared to give it a crack, in our terminology.
It's a great expression.
Give it a crack, get in there, roll your sleeves up, you know, eat what they are eating, drink what they are eating, and sort of try and understand where they're coming from culturally.
You know, a lot of the people that we've been speaking to have been saying, if you go to certain cities now, Shanghai being one example, you have no idea of how rapid the change is in China and what it looks like. What's your experience there?
Oh, well, you've just nailed it. China is developing at a phenomenal rate. Yeah. Currently, I'm based in Hong Kong. I look across the border at Shenzhen. It's a tale of two cities. Hong Kong's trying to reemerge and sort of come out of a difficult period and become part of the Greater Bay Area, whole southern China area. Its economy is starting to grow. It's picking up. But across the border, the economy is just powering ahead. There were more skyscrapers going up there than the whole of Hong Kong in one city. You know, the economy is absolutely on fire.
So how far ahead of the curve is China?
So I would say that today, China consumers set the trends. They lead the world in terms of retail.
Yeah.
A look at their e-commerce and their logistics. We're all sort of scrabbling to chase what's happening in China.
Paying with money, what would that mean?
Paying with money means, I mean, I have cash and people look at me like I'm a dinosaur. Like I'm 58 years old, but they look at me like I'm 158. Where have you been? Why can't you use WeChat Pay or Alipay? I don't think we always understand how far ahead China has got itself in terms of technology and retail capability.
Do you have to physically be there sometimes to see it, to understand it?
Absolutely. What you can't do is you can't sit here in Australia and kind of do it remotely. That'll be a fail.
A big fail?
I would say a big fail. If you want to be successful in China, you need to be in China.
What difference does that make? I mean, it sounds simple, but what practical difference does it make to be there?
I think you can have well-defined commercial business relationships, but what's the glue that holds those things together? That's incredibly important. It's the relationships and the shared vision and the shared purpose which drives success. And to achieve that, you need to be there.
Yeah, once COVID allows us to travel again, you know, I've got groups of senior business leaders, you know, who will fill a jumbo jet to get up there. They want to get up there so quickly, partly because they want to see their own operations and reconnect with their own people.
Yeah.
But they also do want to see what's happening up there. And they want to talk about the big trends, the big things that are happening, so that they can actually work out how that's going to impact down here.
Can't do that on a Zoom call.
You can't do that on a Zoom call. You cannot.
It seems like you want to be in the cockpit flying that jumbo Zoom, or
A380. Yeah, Zoom calls are important just to keep things going when you can, but yeah, get on that plane as soon as you can. It would be my advice to anyone that, you know, really wants to try to track their own trajectory for the years ahead. You know, pre-COVID, there were 400,000 Australians travelling to China during the year before COVID started. 400,000.
For us, not being able to be in China over the last 2 years has caused some challenges. So, one, nobody rings you up and tells you about what's happening in China, you know. They move at their own pace and they don't think about what what's going on in Australia or any other market in the world. So you've got to be there to have your finger on the pulse. Second thing is, connections are so important. Now, the Chinese have a saying, friends before business. And it's true. I can't do business with you if we're not friends. How are we going to become friends? I've got to understand you. How am I going to understand you? I want to see you singing karaoke. I want to see you in a restaurant environment. I want to see you with a few drinks under your belt. How do you behave? What do you really like? And if I can uncover what you really like and I like what I see, then we're good to go. So that's the trick.
How is your karaoke?
My karaoke is, I would say, average. I was lucky because when I was at school, I sang in the choir for 8 years.
So it's got you places.
I don't completely embarrass myself. Look, you got to put your body on the line. You want to build these relationships. You don't say no to karaoke.
Farmers are also known for being plain speakers. So if you were being a plain speaking farmer to our politicians or their politicians, what would you say at the moment?
I think let's get this political situation sorted out, because business people, whoever they are, just want to get on with business and deliver consumers what they want. So it's happening up here in the stratosphere, but it's not always particularly helpful.
But you're committed for the long term.
We are. And if you weren't, you're not going to be successful.
Well, thank you very much for joining us today.
Thank you very much for having me.
Though both Ben and David come from different worlds, they enjoy a similar perspective born out of experience. Their collective view echoes an aphorism penned by Confucius nearly 2,500 years ago. Better a diamond with a flaw than a pebble without.
The reality is there is no other market in the world that comes near the providing the demand for the sort of premium products and services that we sell to China. You know, India, Indonesia, the whole of the ASEAN nations. You know, fantastic markets, absolutely fantastic markets. But you put them all together and there is no way that they could fill the void if we were to move away from and decouple from the China market.
Not a scratch.
Not a scratch. So the language that we've been using within the Business Council is China Plus. And the idea behind that is that you look at what you've got in the China market now and you manage it. You try to preserve it and keep it as strong as possible. And at the same time, you add to it by looking at other markets. That adding to it is a way of managing the risk associated with quite a strong market in China, diversifying your risk and managing it elsewhere. So in many respects, you know, while some people talk about diversification in negative terms, I like to think of it as growing the pie. You know, you grab what you've got, you look at it really carefully, you manage the risks around that, and then at the same time, think about other markets and how you might be able to use, you know, your China expertise and capabilities to develop elsewhere.
Are you still excited or a little scared looking at the future?
I'm concerned that, right, you know, we're in a difficult place.
Do you look back and think, how the hell did we get here?
Well, hindsight's a good thing, isn't it? You know, for the last 25 years, you know, I've been looking at China and going to China. You know, there's a game plan. You know, China has been very clear about its ambitions. You know, admittedly, it's been biding its time for quite a period of time, but it's been very clear when you look at its five-year plans and then its longer-term, you know, strategies, that it wants to be a global power. What we should be focused on is ensuring that Australian business has a seat at the table at all the right conversations.
Particularly if the people at the table aren't talking to each other.
Exactly right. Now, you know, right now there are many areas where Australia and China, you know, are at one in terms of our desire to resolve a problem. You know, climate change, absolute obvious, you know, candidate for us to get together to be able to talk about opportunities to work together for mutual advantage to achieve our own respective net zero carbon targets.
So deep down, it feels that you might be a bit more optimistic than you started this conversation.
Look, I am optimistic. You know, I guess I'm a glass half full sort of person. I think if you don't approach problems with a positive outlook and at least an anticipation that there might be a good outcome ahead, you'll get drowned in everything that's happening at the moment. You know, we're awash with bad news at the moment, and you know, we need to have hope.
Well, on that message of hope, thank you very much for joining the program.
My pleasure. Thank you.